It is a huge honor to be in the capital of Cambodia. We are in Phnom Penh, Cambodia, with a legendary dentist leader from Cambodia, Dr. Sok Chea, who has three dental offices around the capital. And your clinic is, your dental office is absolutely beautiful. It's amazing. It's state of the art. It's as nice a dental office I've seen in any country around the world. So so you're a third generation dentist.
Yes, I'm a third generation.
So tell us about, so your grandfather and dad were dentists.
Yes, the traditional dentist. Yes, my grandfather's from, my grandmother from China, and my father's born here. And then we are practicing dentistry over 73 years now.
Now, were all three of you ever practicing at the same time?
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
So when you got out of dental school, your grandfather and your dad and you were all practicing at the same time?
Yeah, we're practicing dentistry, but my grandfather and my dad, we call traditional dentists. It means he learned from generation to generation.
Meaning they didn't go to school?
Yeah, they didn't go to school.
Your grandfather and your dad never went to school?
Yes.
So that's what called a traditional dentist?
Yeah, we call traditional dentist because my grandfather, he learned dentistry from my great-grandfather. They're like a traditional
way. Your grandfather learned from his great-grandfather?
Yeah.
So you're a fourth generation dentist?
Actually, a fourth generation, but in Cambodia, there's three generation.
But in your family, it's four generations.
Yes, of course.
So what do we call that when you learn from your, what would that be called when you learn it from your father? It would be a, they call it a traditional dentist.
Yeah, here we call it traditional.
We call it a, an apprentice.
Yeah, apprenticeship.
Or a mentorship. So,
So
all throughout history, people would learn their skill from their father, their family, a mentor. Were you the first to go to school, university?
Yes, I'm the first.
Wow.
But now there are my brother, sister, cousins, around 40 people, my relatives. They are in the universities. Some of them graduated, some of them still in the...
You mean 40 now?
Yes.
You have 40 in your family in dental school or dentist?
Yes.
And how much
members.
How much is that because of you?
Yes, maybe, I think.
That is so amazing. I think you have 40. Who was our friend in Brazil, Dr. Christian Coachman? Have you heard of Dr. Christian Coachman?
Yes.
I think he has 35 in their family. So you beat Christian Coachman from São Paulo, Brazil. Yeah, I think you're the number one most dentist in the family at 40. I have not heard anybody with that many. That's amazing.
Yes, because my father families and my mother family also coming from traditional dentistry. My grandfather's practicing dentistry before our dental school opens. Yeah, because our dental school opened in 1956.
In
Phnom Penh.
In Phnom Penh.
Yeah, the history of our dental schools. My grandfather, he practicing dentistry in 1942.
Wow. So now, your grandfather in China, whereabouts in China were they from?
They're from Hubei, like at the central of China.
Central China?
Yeah.
So did you retain any Chinese language?
No.
You don't speak Chinese?
Yes. But my sister, she can speak Chinese. But for me, because we grow up during the wartime, you know, and then at that time, they would not allow you to study Chinese.
In Cambodia?
Yes, study Chinese and English was illegal that time.
During what time? Which war?
During the Khmer Rouge time and
the Khmer Rouge.
The communist time. Yes, from the 1975 to 1987.
So from 1975 to 1989.
87.
From 75 to 87.
Yeah.
The Khmer Rouge would not let
Yes, Khmer Rouge, and the Khmer Rouge took over for 3.5 years, and then the Vietnamese came, and then studied Chinese or English or French was illegal at that time.
Wow.
Because we were under the socialist parties.
So when did they, so that, so in 87, they liberated to be able to go and learn?
Yeah, from 87, they are a little bit open, but still a very strict control. They're just only in the cities, not in the province. The provincial levels still under control.
We went to the genocide museum yesterday.
Oh, you went there.
That was amazing. That was an amazingly difficult time, wasn't it?
Yes, of course. Since 1975 to 1979, it almost 4 years, but almost 2 million people was killed or starvation at that time.
Yeah, what would you, there's dentists listening to you right now from 153 countries. They might not have heard about.
Yes, it's very sad stories.
And so I noticed, so in Southeast Asia, who are your number one leaders for dentistry? Walking around your office, I would think it would be Korea. You seem to have a lot of Korean influence. Is Korea the number one influence?
I think for me is Japan.
It's Japan.
Yes, because I was trained in Japan.
You went to dental school in Japan?
No. I do my postgraduate here, and then I got like a short-term clinical training in Japan. Yes, because one of my professor, he's a Japanese, he supported me in 2001, so I went to Japan for...
Now, did you have to learn Japanese, or could they speak
Cambodian?
No, because
we went to the international department, so that they use English.
Oh, so in 1981, you already knew English?
No, I studied English in 1991.
91?
Yeah, 1991, when the United Nations Security Forces came to Cambodia after the peace agreement between the guerrilla side and the government side. We have peace agreement in 1991, we call Paris Peace Agreement, because the agreement was signed in Paris. And that time, they allowed the United Nations Security Forces took over the power here. So that's why many young generation, they learn English, because they think they can get more money when they work with the United Nations. So I was the one. I used to work for the United Nations.
You used to work for the United Nations?
Yeah, as a local translator.
Wow. And so how long did you study in Japan?
Yeah, yes, about almost 1 year.
1 year in Japan?
Yeah. But I did my postgraduate for 3 years here. Yeah, and then 1 year just observed the case in Japan.
Yeah.
Yeah, like because before we didn't have periodontists. We didn't have periodontists. So I'm the first periodontist now still giving lecture at the universities.
In Cambodia. And you were the first dentist to place an implant.
Yes.
What year was that?
In 2001.
Wow.
In 2001, 16 years ago.
How cool is that to be the first dentist to place a dental implant? And you were the first periodontist?
Yes.
And the first to place a dental implant?
Yes.
So in 1981?
In 2001.
In 2001?
Yeah, in 2001.
And what implant did you place in 2001?
3i. The first 3i. Implant system was 3i.
And where was 3i out of? Well, where was 3i from?
3i is from United States.
But
at that time,
do you remember what city it was?
Yeah, we orders from Singapore. From Singapore.
Okay, Singapore?
Yeah.
And then you've changed most, so you've changed implant systems over the years.
Yes.
Why did you quit using 3i, and what did you go to
it's
next?
It's quite expensive price, yeah.
Okay, so
and
it's price.
I'm looking for other implant system that is suitable to the Cambodian market, so that's why the first time I select Indopore, you know Indopore?
Endopore?
Yeah, endopore, like a microporosity implant surface.
And who made endopore?
From Toronto University, Canada.
Toronto?
Yeah, Canada.
Can you find that, Ryan? Endopore?
Yeah, endopore.
Text that to me.
From Indowear companies, Indowear Endopores.
So it was what?
Indowear endopore.
Okay, yes. Endopore?
Yeah, endopore.
And then what's implant next?
And then for a short period of time, I use ankylose.
Ankylose, yes. That was Dentsply?
Yeah, from Dentsplies, and then I changed to Stroman. Yeah, Stroman.
Stroman out of Seoul, South Korea.
Yeah, and the other two implants.
No, Stroman was in Switzerland.
From Switzerland.
Switzerland.
Yeah.
But they just bought Megagen in Seoul, South Korea.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
So which one are you using now?
The Stroman. ITI, at that time we called ITI Stroman implant system, mm-hmm. but now ITI is separate from Stroman. So, but we still use Stroman's in my office.
You still use Stroman?
Yeah, I still use.
And how many implant systems do you use today?
Today, there are three implant systems that is daily use in my clinics. Three implant systems. The first one is Stroman, and the second one is from MIS, MIS. From
MIS? What does MIS stand for?
Make it simple.
Make it simple. Is that out of Israel?
It is originally from Israel.
Israel?
Yeah. And now they moved to German. The factory, they moved to German.
Who bought MIS?
I don't know.
Ryan, who bought MIS? Someone just bought it. So you use Stroman, MIS.
Yeah.
And what's the
Neobiotics.
Third? Neobiotics.
Yeah, Neobiotics.
Out of Seoul, out of Korea?
Yes, from Korea.
Dentsply Serona bought MIS. But so name the top for Korean implants. Name the first, second, third, fourth. One would be Ostium.
In Korea, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ostium be number one?
Yeah, number one, Ostium.
And then number two?
Neobiotics.
Yeah.
Number three, I think Dentium. Dentium, that's one. And the fourth, Megagen, and the other one is Dentist. There are five top implant systems in Korea. The Ostium, Neobiotic, Dentium, Megagen, and Dentist.
So for when you're looking at an implant system, when you're for Cambodia, for your three offices, was cost a major factor? You were looking for affordability of an implant system?
Yes. Because, I have been placing lots of implants, and then I think more and more people, they demand immediate provisional restoration or immediate implant loading. So I go to Korea, and then I met one of the founder of Neobiotics. He said his implant system can be used as the immediate loading and immediate provisional restoration.
And what was his name? What's his name?
Professor Her. Her.
Do you still talk with him?
Yes.
Can you email me, howard@dentaltown.com, and CC him and introduce us?
Yes.
I would love to meet him.
Okay. Good. I will do it. And then I tried first time he sent me 10 implants for immediate provisional restoration, full mouth. And I got the result very nice. Yeah, that's why I start to use his implant system. From now on, we have been placed about 2,500 implants, his implant system already. But no problem for me.
You've already placed 2,500?
Yes.
2,500?
Neobiotics within 3 years.
2,500 within 3 years?
Yes.
That's a lot of implants.
Yep.
Not many people. That's almost what, 800 implants a year?
Yeah, almost 700 plus, I think.
700 implants a year. That is amazing. So what is, so in Cambodia, why do people, when someone needs an implant, is it usually to replace one tooth? Is it they lose a tooth and you replace one missing tooth? Is it that they have no teeth and you place two implants for a denture? What is your standard implant case in Cambodia?
It depends on the case, and it depends on the people who can afford can afford the money, you know, to place an implant. But for old people, we recommend two or four implants for overdenture.
And what do you prefer, two or four?
Yeah, it depends on the case for me. Yeah. But mostly I do four.
And is it four with ball and rings, or do you like to make a bar?
Locator. The most common use in my office. I do use, we call a telescopic bar, you know, like mm-hmm. a telescopic bar.
Mm-hmm. You like the telescopic bar?
Yeah, and then locators, and the other is ball attachment.
So what do you do the most of? Telescopic, bar, ball and ring?
The most is locators. Yeah, because I love locators.
Which is a ball and ring? A ball and socket?
Yes. Some kind like a, not a ball, but like male and female.
Okay.
Yeah, male and female.
And are you usually doing two or four?
Four, mostly.
Mostly four?
Yep.
Is that the majority? You're placing about 700 implants a year. How many of those 700 would be for removable, for dentures and partials, versus for a single fixed crown?
Yeah, you mean percentage or?
Yeah, percentage.
So percentage, I think maybe 20%.
Would be removable?
Yeah, would be removable.
Yeah. So you studied in Japan. You've been to Korea. Do you think in Cambodia, do you think the diet affects disease differently than, say, France or Japan? Is there more sugar in the diet, less sugar in the diet? Do you think it has an effect on decay and cavities versus, say, London or Paris? Or do you see any ethnic, diet, cultural, genetic differences in the disease, cavity, gum disease patterns in Cambodia than the rest of the world?
But we didn't pay much attention on it. But for my Western patient, when they came to see my office, I rarely see that they have a multi caries.
Western patients have more caries?
No. They have less.
They have less caries.
Less caries. But for like Chinese people or like Indian people, they have more caries.
And do you think that's because of their diet, or do you think it's how they brush and floss?
I think so, like education.
Education
is very important because Western people they very aware of dental health, so they try to keep their health clean. But Chinese people, they smoke a lot.
Smoke a lot of tobacco.
Yeah, and then mostly they have a gum problem.
So if you see Cambodian people in the rural, where they don't have access to like Coke or Pepsi, or food, do they have less cavities than
in the urban
city, or do they have the same amount?
The people living in the rural areas. I'm also one of the volunteer team that we are going to the province every 2 months to join the dental mission. We offer free treatment for the children, and I found
that is so amazing. That is so amazing that you're part of the mission.
Yes.
To take that is so cool.
Regularly.
We
have done for 5 years already.
Good for you.
Yeah. And then I found some people the children living along the river, they seen they don't have much caries.
So like the children along the river don't have many caries.
The people living outside the people living in the middle of the countries, they're living with a very poor condition, and then I talking about the how to say snacks like a biscuit, like
snacks.
Coke. So there's no one control it, so there is many kinds of problem, oral problem. I can see the especially dental caries, gum problems.
So who eats the most snacks? The kids along the river or the kids in main inland, in the rural?
Yeah, the kid along the river, I think they have a very good nutrition, I think. Because
they're eating
can
fish
find
out
fish.
Of the river?
Yeah, and then they live in a a better living condition as comparing with the people living in the mountainside and living in the central of Cambodia. So they're living like a farmers, like the kid at the farmers, the place. They have many, many caries.
Do you also see any difference in the caries? This is a very multicultural society. Cultures like people from India versus China versus Cambodian versus Malaysian. Do you see any cultures having more cavities or less cavities because something they're doing culturally, like say diet or?
No, I didn't have experience with the outside country to the community areas, but I have been traveling many, many places in Cambodia. So I comparing the people living in the riverside, living in the mountainside, and living in the central side. So we can see the difference.
And you say the main difference is snacking on?
Yeah, snacks and nutrition.
Yeah.
Education, no, like a school snack and living condition.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
so
what I found
the,
it.
The food is medicine, isn't it?
Yes. Because I think like people living in the river, they eat fish. So right. They contain a lot of proteins and it's good for health.
So Cambodia has 15 million people with 2,000 dentists. And you were telling me that you have five dental schools. One is a government dental school, Health mm-hmm. Science University of Cambodia.
Yep.
Then there's a military dental school. And then there's three private dental schools. Mm. And so that's five dental schools altogether.
Yes.
Do you think Cambodia needs more dentists? Do they have enough dentists? Do they need more dental schools? Do they have too many dental schools? What do you think about the supply of the number of dentists being created versus the population of 15 million people?
And now we have two levels of the people who can practicing dentistry. The first level we call dentist, yeah, and the second level we call a dental nurse, but they also can practicing dentistry. So it is now, I think now we are worried about overproduction of the dentist and the dental nurse.
Overproduction?
Yes.
So, because, you know, how many years does it take to be a dentist?
7 years.
7 years?
Yes.
At the same school?
Yeah. At the.
So a dentist is 7 years?
Because we have a national curriculums.
And how long does it take to become a dental nurse?
A dental nurse for 3 years.
And what can a dental nurse do?
Yeah, they say there are some limited practicings in dentistry, but in the realities, clinically, a dental nurse doing everything. Yeah, also dentist and also implant as well. That's why
we. So a dental nurse goes 3 years and does the same thing.
Yes. But by law, they say it's you cannot do implant, prosthodontic surgery. Gum operation, but in the reality, they doing everything.
So, what is your view on dental nurses?
Yeah, I'm not support the government policy that allow the dental nurse practicing privately. You know, independently, they should work with dentists. They should do their oral health education at the health centers or the referral hospitals. But now the government have produced too many dental nurses. So
when you said that Cambodia has 2,000 dentists, that was just 2,000 dentists. That didn't include dental nurses?
Not including.
How many dental nurses do you
think? I think about 1,600.
So Cambodia has 2,000 dentists and 1,600 dental nurses?
Yes.
And what do you think the government's argument was to create dental nurses? Why did the government create a dental nurse that only took half the time as the to become a dentist?
Because they said dentists just willing to work in the city or in the provincial town. That's why they said dental nurse can go to the community levels, so right. can offer the cheap treatment for the local people.
In the but rural. In,
yeah,
in
yes,
the rural.
Yes. But in fact, all those dental nurses after graduate, they move to the city, the same as dentists.
It's so funny. I always call these podcasts lessons from Singapore, or lessons from Cambodia, or lessons from Thailand. And in every country you go to, the government says, if we create dental nurses or dental therapists or whatever you want to call them, they'll go to the rural where they need dentists. And then they never do.
Yeah.
They never do. They you're doing missionary work.
Yes.
Out in the rural. Do you see dentists, young dentists, like will Henry go far out into the rural, or will he stay in the big city of Phnom Penh?
No.
Henry, where are you going? Are you gonna go way out into
Definitely
the jungle?
Definitely he will stay in Phnom Penh.
Yeah.
Now, there's no doubt.
So is there anything, how long can I ask how old you are?
Yes, 44.
So in your 44 years and your fourth generation dentist,
yep.
do you think there's any policy that could be done to make young Henrys go up the river?
Yeah, I think the government should change the policy, you know, because the government, they said, if you want to work for the government in the rural areas, you have to work for 5 years at the rural areas. But actually, they don't go. I think they should change if they just giving 2 years opportunities to work in the rural community, and then they can, if you want to change, after 2 years, you can change it.
So you're saying that maybe they should, when they graduate from dental school, they should have to do a residency in the rural.
Yes, but for 2 years, not 5 years.
2 years.
Because 5 years too long, they will not go. If 2 years, I think we can encourage the young dentist with going for 2 year residency. And then after 2 years, you can change, or you can move, or you can stop from working the government. And then the other student will go, after they graduate, they will go to replace them.
And you know, one of, something I find very interesting is that, you know, in the United States, the American Dental Association recommends 9 specialties. And I remember them by the mnemonic Pope Poodoo, P-O-P-E, P-O-O-D-O, periodontist, orthodontist. But one of those specialties is dental public health.
Yep.
And it seems like at every dental convention, every dental magazine, they always talk about orthodontics, endodontics, periodontics, but no one really talks about public health.
Yes,
very. And this is a very good public health conversation, because there is a lot of people in the rural. Every country you go to, there is a lot of poor people in the rural that don't have access to care.
Yes,
and a lot of the modern day solutions of creating dental therapists, or it's still not getting people out there. But your idea that when you come out of school, do a 2 year residency way out in the rural. You would like that idea.
Yes, that's good.
And then they would work for the government? The government would pay them? Or who would pay
the government would pay them.
Yeah?
Yeah. But they have to exactly go to the rural areas.
Yeah.
But in Cambodia, the reality is when the government send their name to the rural areas, but they're still working in the Phnom Penh. They're still working in the city. They will not go to the rural areas because of the... The first important thing is very, very basic salaries, very low salaries that force him to stay in Phnom Penh. And the second thing, the dental supplies, you know, like because in the rural areas, 80% of the health centers or 80% of the referral hospitals, there's no dental chair.
So why is that when you go around the world, if you went to a hospital, they could fix a heart attack. If you had a tumor in your brain, they could fix a tumor in your brain. They could take out your appendix, deliver a baby. But in every hospital around the world, if you go in there with a toothache, to the finest hospital in Tokyo or Singapore or Phnom Penh, there's not one hospital in the world that can take an x-ray of a tooth and pull a tooth or do a root canal. Is that the same in Cambodia? Do any hospitals in Cambodia, could I go in with a toothache and they fix a tooth? Could they?
Yes, we do have, but only in the main cities.
In the main cities?
Yeah, in the main cities.
So in the main city of Cambodia, if you went to a hospital, you could have a heart attack or a toothache, and the same hospital would fix you?
Yeah, but some hospitals, they have a dental service, but the others, they don't have.
Some do, though.
Yeah.
I've never seen one. You'll have to put me in your car and drive me to this hospital. I want to see, it'd be the first hospital I saw with my own eyes. I always think it's funny that they can deliver a baby and remove a brain tumor, but they can't fix a tooth.
At the same time?
Not in the same hospital. In the United States, 8% of the people that go to the emergency room in a hospital, it's from odontogenic tooth origin.
Mm-hmm.
And all they do is give you penicillin and Vicodin or oxycodone and say, good luck. They just give you antibiotics. No treatment. But if you went in there and had a broken arm or a leg or were about to deliver a baby, they could do all that. But 8% is almost 10%. Wouldn't you think if you owned a grocery store and one in every 10 of your customers came in and asked for something and you said, I don't sell that? Don't you think a grocery store after 100 years would say, maybe we should sell that? But not in dentistry. So let's switch gears from rural to urban. So we're in Cambodia, 15 million people. How many people live in the capital here of Phnom Penh?
Yeah, now we have, 2 million plus.
This is a big city.
Yeah, the big city.
And I love it. I've been, when we got here, we went on a
It's really
six...
crowded. Really crowded in rush hour time. I think we are one of the worst traffic.
Well, we walked. We didn't, day one, we went on a 6-hour circle walk. Just loved it. My question is for the basics. Does Phnom Penh use water fluoridation? What is Cambodia's thoughts on water fluoridation?
No, we don't have that program.
No. Do you think they need the program, or do you not think they need? Because I noticed like Tokyo has fluoridated water. Singapore does not. So there's two cities very close to each other.
Mm.
What is your view on water fluoridation?
Yeah, in Cambodia we also face the same problem, you know. The JICA expert said in Cambodia water you don't need to add fluoridation because it already contains some of them.
Yep.
But some areas too much fluoride.
Yep.
Like in the province nearby the cities, we found that the waters contain too much fluoride. So they said it is not necessary to place fluoride inside the waters.
So in Phnom Penh of 2 million people, it's probably more than one water supply.
Yes.
It's probably multiple water supplies, right? In a town that big?
Right.
They're probably getting some out of the river, some out of the ground.
Yeah, underground.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm in Arizona, and the city just 30 miles south of me, Casa Grande, naturally comes out at 4 parts per million. And then 3 hours north in the Tuba City Navajo Indian Reservation, it comes out 44 parts per million. So yeah, the natural fluoride varies amazingly different.
Different.
Yeah, yeah. So, okay, let's stay in the urban diet-wise. The people of Cambodia, 2 million people, do you think their decay is more from what they eat, or do you think it's from because they don't maybe brush and floss? Do you think it's more home care or diet or a combination of the both?
Yeah, I think in Cambodia the most problem is education. Yeah, oral health care is education. Because some Cambodian family they don't care the oral health for the children. They think it is not necessary to brush the teeth for their kids because their kids are going to replace, the teeth will be replaced by the permanent after 10 years or something like that, you know. They believe that, so it's doing it. But now a young generation, the people who have a high education, they take care of their kids when the baby teeth is coming. So they really care about oral hygiene comparing with the poor community levels. they don't care much about oral health. So the problem is education, I think.
Now, is there a specialty in the capital? Are there pediatric dentists who just specialize in children, or do you not see that specialty?
Yeah, we do have pediatric dentistry dentists here.
Very many?
Not so many. Very few. They graduate, but they're not practicing.
They go to school?
Yes. Yeah, they go to school, but very, very few dentists doing pediatric dentists.
And you think it's because the parents don't value it, so there's not a big demand for it?
Yeah, right now, I think. But in the next 5 years, I think maybe they change a lot.
Because let's talk about those 2,000 dentists in Cambodia. Are they, what percent are men, what percent are women, and has that changed over the last 25 years?
Yes. In my days, in my generation, my class, there are no girl. 20 students, all boys, no girl in my generation. And my senior as well, very few numbers of girl students. But now, I think they change a lot. Now, each class, they have almost 30 to 40% of them. Of girls students. That's quite a big change.
Henry, what percent of your class is women?
Maybe 60% men, 40%.
60% men, 40% women?
Yeah.
Interesting. Do you think the male dentists from your generation do not like working on children? Do you think the women dentists do you think the males from your generation really didn't like working on kids?
Yes.
And do you think if the class is 40% women, do you think the women dentists will like working on little kids more than you did?
I can say for my personal experience, my dentist who worked with me, I think female dentist, she's like feeling happy to treat the children. But for my male dentist, they are not very much happy to treat the children.
Yeah, and
females.
Do you think that's biology? Do you think women who have maternal instincts
are
more hardwired at birth
and then,
to treat a child?
Yeah,
see, if you say that, people would just say you're crazy.
That is natural.
You think it's natural, yeah.
Yeah, it's natural.
This is Dentistry Uncensored, so we talk about anything that's politically incorrect or not, but a lot of people believe that women are hardwired with maternal instincts and feel more natural with children.
Right, right.
And it seems like, I'm 54, it seems like every man I know who's 40, 50, 60 says that the number one procedure they hate to do is work on a crying kid. I mean, I've heard that. I've heard that in so many countries. I've heard it on every continent except Antarctica. I have to ask a penguin to see. So of the other specialties, I would say that since you became a dentist, one of the biggest brands ever created on Earth was Invisalign.
Yeah, Invisalign.
Have you seen, since you got out of school to now, have you seen Invisalign become popular in Cambodia?
Yes,
or not really?
Not really, because Invisalign now came to Cambodian markets about 2 years now.
But 2 years ago?
Yeah, 2 years ago. But I think it's not so much popular among the dentists.
And why do you think that is?
I think the first is the price. It's still expensive for the Cambodian market, I think.
And do you see, what about orthodontics in general? Is orthodontics?
Yes, now very popular among the young generation, especially the people living in the cities.
Orthodontics?
Yeah, increasing. It's much increasing.
Over how many years?
Orthodontist, I think, is 3 or 4 years, these 3 or 4 years.
And in your three dental offices, do you call them dental offices or dental clinics?
Dental clinic.
In your three dental clinics, do you do orthodontics?
Yes, we have two orthodontists.
Two orthodontists. And what percent of their patients are girls versus boys?
The orthodontist patient?
Yeah.
That's girl more than boys.
Like what percent? What percent would be girls?
I think maybe 60%.
60% girls?
Yeah, girl, yeah.
So do you see the Cambodian market seeing orthodontics more to do with cosmetic beauty as opposed to dental function and health?
Yes, for the beauties.
It's more for beauty?
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's talk about endo. Do you talk about the endo market? Do you do a lot of root canals?
Yes.
And what is your common endodontic technique these days?
Yeah, we have endodontic rotary machine that we can do it. We use two different system. The one is from Dentsply, and the other one from I don't know, but from Cyprus.
Cyprus?
Yeah.
Or Cybron?
Cybron.
Cybron?
Yeah.
And which systems are you? What endo systems are you using from Dentsply and Cybron?
I don't know exactly. I think my dentist know much more that better than me because I do only perio and implants.
You only do perio and implants?
Yes.
And then let's switch to restorative materials. In your three dental clinics in Phnom, what percent of your molar restorations are amalgam versus composite versus glass ionomer?
Now, the first I have to say amalgam because my dentist, he says still prefer amalgam because it's cheap and we can do it faster than composite. And we do all amalgam, composite, and glass ionomers, but they prefer first amalgam in my clinics. But now we change. Before we change some policies in the clinic, you know, like in the frontage, before we use metal post. And now, just recently I changed, I call all my dentists having a meeting, and then we have to change metal post into composite post with a fiber post reinforcement.
For cosmetics?
Yeah, for cosmetic.
But how long do you think an amalgam on a first molar and a three surface MOD amalgam, how long do you think that would last versus a three surface MOD resin composite?
For me, I still feel good with amalgam because I still see, I did the case 10 or 15 years ago, and then the patient come and see me, still functioning.
I think it's amazing. I think the human condition is they start with what they want to believe. And so they just want to believe the tooth color ones are pretty, but it seems like, you know, I love research. And it seems like everything I'm reading on research that the MOD amalgams last 20 to 38 years, and the resin composites last 6.5 years. And they don't want to believe that. And in fact, as you go to, there's just so many dentists that they don't even offer amalgam. Yeah, I just think that's bizarre.
The people living in Europe, they say no amalgam.
I know, and it's bizarre because you would think if you went to a doctor, the doctor should say,
clinically,
hey, I could give you this the last 38 years or this the last 6 years, and you call yourself a doctor and you don't even offer the treatment the last 38 years?
Yeah, you're right.
I just think.
I still use amalgam
This is why it's Dentistry Uncensored, because I'm the only dentist that tells my homies, you're batshit crazy. You're crazy. I mean, imagine if you had prostate cancer. They said, well, we have two treatments. One will keep you alive 6.5 years, and one will keep you alive 38 and a half years. But we don't do the one that lasts 38 and a half years.
Yeah.
So we're going to treat your prostate with this, and you'll be dead in 6.5 years. You're like, what?
I think
you're a doctor?
Yes, one of the problem because amalgam, they never do advertisement.
Yeah.
Yeah. But composite, many kind of composite, you know, many company doing advertisement, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. But amalgam don't need. But people still believe in amalgam, especially the people who work in dentistry over than 10 years, they will find, amalgam is good, better than composite. For me, I still use amalgam.
Yeah, it's a superior restoration.
Yeah.
And like especially for men, because like when you're talking to me and I'm talking to you, I have still not seen one of your molars. I mean, I'm a dentist. I'm trying to see your molars. I just seen the very edges of the front teeth.
Right.
Like I have 7 restorations. Do you know if they're composite? Do you know what my restorations are made out of?
Composite, amalgam.
Say they're all seven. They're all gold. All you gold. Haven't seen one of my gold yet, have you?
Oh. Yeah.
So why would you tell a man, well, we need to make this cosmetic when men don't ever show their molars? I mean, the only person, you see, you just laughed, and I saw eight upper teeth. I still haven't seen one of your molars. So two dentists can talk to each other for an hour and never see their molars. Yeah, they'll do composites on man's molars because they're a cosmetic dentist. The thing will fail in 6.5 years. It's garbage. And they didn't even offer the patient, well, do you want gold, which I consider permanent, or amalgam, which is half a lifetime, 38 years.
Yeah, we feel the same. For me, I always recommend my patient, the first option, if you can afford the price, gold is number one for the molars.
Yeah.
So don't talk about zirconium, ceramic, first talking about gold.
Yeah.
Because in Cambodia, quite expensive gold, you know.
I want to switch completely out of dentistry. I've lectured in 50 countries. I usually drag Ryan and Greg and Zach. I think last year, how many countries did I drag you boys to?
A lot.
I mean, a dozen.
Yeah.
But I call it the crane factor. The crane.
Crane.
You go to some countries and their economy is going nowhere. And when you're there, you can smell it. There's no cranes. There's no construction. Like, you could drive around Italy. You could literally drive around Italy. You could rent a car and drive for a week and not see one crane. And then you go to some cities and you look out the window and you can see 10 cranes from your hotel window. So going around the world, this city is exploding. There's more cranes. There's more construction. There's more cranes and construction in Phnom Penh
than
the entire country of Italy, which has 75 million people. What is driving this economy? Why is Cambodia exploding with cranes and skyscrapers wall to wall? What's driving it?
Because people believe in peace, you know, because in the past 20, 30 years ago, we have war, internal war, outside war, and then political conflict. So we don't have much time to invest because we think it's not secure enough, not peace enough. But right now, we have 100% peace. You can walk anywhere, even at nighttime, it's very safe in Phnom Penh now. So people believe that we have peace, and that's why they're willing to invest on the construction, willing to invest for their future. That's why you see within 3 or 4 years time, very much change. I have my friend who come 5 years ago, and then they come back again and they say, wow, why so much change? Very fast.
Do you have a lot of personal pain from your childhood past in Cambodia during living through Khmer Rouge or those times?
I'm not much remember during the Khmer Rouge time, but after Khmer Rouge, we're still living in a very poor condition, you know. I'm living in a province where I never expect I get a high education. If I have one boat, can fish, that's enough for my life at that time. Because my hometown living along the river, so we just want to survive day by day. We never expect to be like this. Yes.
So would you say that today you're living the dream? That this was a dream as a child.
This is not my dream.
It's not your dream.
Yeah, my dream. I said if I grow up and then I have one boat and one fishing net, that is enough for me. Because we was born during the war time, you know, we have seen a lot of people was killed by bomb, by gun, you know.
And which wars are you talking about mostly? Are you talking about the Vietnam War?
After Khmer Rouge, there is the guerrilla war between the Khmer Rouge and the new government. That time, the new government backed by the Vietnamese. The Vietnamese support the new government, and then we have a war.
And then the guerrillas fought
The guerrilla, yeah.
And then who won, the Vietnamese-backed government?
No, it's... Because I'm living in the central of Cambodia, where the fighting it depends on the season, you know. In dry season, the government took over my hometown. But in rainy season, the gorilla back. You know why?
Because the rain would make the roads sloshy.
Yeah,
and
so the government cannot send their armors or heavy gun, you know, to their areas, so that the Khmeros came from the jungle and then they fought back and then they took over control my hometown. So in my hometown is some kind of like a, in the middle.
Do you think that you or I will live long enough to see the end of war?
No, I don't know.
Do you think so or do you think not?
Yes, now many international problem, you know.
So you think there'll be war? How long do you think there'll still be war? 50 years, 100,000, how long?
No, maybe no end.
And then, so I'm trying to think, I covered endo, perio. Let's go to periodontics. You were a periodontist.
Yes.
I would say that in my lifetime, of the 9 specialties of endodontics, prosthodontics, pediatric dentistry, dental public health, oral surgery, oral radiology, I would say periodontics changed more than all the specialties.
Yeah, you're right.
In the 30 years. This is, I graduated in 87, this is 2017, so this is my 30 year anniversary. Periodontics changed the most. Where was it when you got out of school? And when you got out of school, what did you believe when you became a periodontist and that you did every day, and now you don't even do that anymore, or you don't believe that anymore? What changes have you seen since you became a periodontist?
What change? A periodontist, periodontal disease. One of the problem that I understand, now I treat many diabetic patient. Yeah, because half of my periodontal's treatments, my patient are diabetes.
And is that something that's, do you think diabetes used to always exist in Cambodia and was just not diagnosed? Or do you think diabetes is rising because of some change like diet?
Yes, that's one of the problem. And the other thing, they, you know, now they have a, before they never have their regular checkup. They don't know they have diabetes. Even they come to my office and then they have a problem, and then I said, you better go and check up your health. And then...
But do you think diabetes was very common in Cambodia before
there was any
medicine?
No, it's very common for the high-class people.
So you think it's more common for the high-class?
Yes.
So why you think the high-class people have it more than 100 years ago?
Yeah, I think, personally, I think maybe in the past 20 years ago, you know, the rich family, they never enjoyed their life. They have no time to enjoy their life. Now when they open the market, they get rich. So they tend to drink a lot, eat a lot. They never care about exercise, you know. That's why most of them suffer with systemic diseases.
And what diabetic complications are you seeing as a periodontist?
Yeah, like deep pocket. Yeah, generalized periodontal disease.
So when you see patients who have a lot of generalized periodontal disease, they're more likely to be diabetics.
Yes.
And the diabetes is more likely to be non-treated. They're not on insulin. They're not being treated.
It means they are taking regular exercise, they are taking medicines, so it's easy for me to treat the periodontal disease as well.
When you were little and you just became a periodontist, you would do scaling and root planing and gum surgeries on 3 rooted maxillary molars. Today, are you still doing that, or would you be more likely to extract the 3 rooted molar and place a titanium implant?
Yes, for me, I would, if in the case like a patient who have fixation, then my first option is depend on the patient economy, you know, and his or oral health care understanding. If they are good, oral health care, and then we try to keep it. if they are not so much interesting in oral health care, I prefer to take it out.
So you would say that if there's three rooted teeth, a furcation involvement,
yeah,
or a trifurcation, that if they have good brushing and flossing and home care, you try to save the natural
tooth? Yeah, I try
tooth.
To save.
But if they don't have good home care, you think a better bet is with titanium implant?
Yes, I take it out, and then we think about implants.
Yeah, that is very interesting. Very interesting. What percent of your Cambodia is flossing very common?
I don't know exactly, but it is increasing number. Yeah.
It's now, flossing is increasing.
Yeah, because I have seen many of my patients, they come into my office asking for floss. And then
let's switch to Crown and Bridge. As the of your 2,000 Cambodian dentists, do most people take an impression, send it to the lab?
Yes, most people.
And what type of impression are they taking, and what are they making at the lab? Is it porcelain fused to metal? Is it CAD/CAM zirconium?
I think now we have CAD/CAM, but very few cases. We're still very limited in the market. But the most common is metal fused to porcelain.
Porcelain fused to metal.
Yeah,
metal. That's the most common?
Yeah, the most common one.
Right on. So my last question, you've been so amazing. I really love this interview. What do you... a lot of people might not be aware of your Angkor walk. Everybody that I've ever known that went to Cambodia. So the coolest thing of all of Cambodia is Angkor Wat. Have you been there?
Yeah, many times.
Many times. Tell everybody about Angkor Wat.
Well, it's a very, very nice place and very amazing place. And then now we want to change the what the people think about Cambodia in the past 20 years, you know. Like some of my friends, they said Cambodian... The image, like in Africa, they think Cambodian facing with war, with diseases, and with poverty. But now that's like what I want all of you friends have to change. Cambodian now we have peace and very peaceful, and then we have many tourist sites. Angkor Wat is number one. But not only Angkor Wat, we also have a natural resort. I think one of the best resorts in the world, because I like traveling as well. And then I went to the sea, to the mountains. Now it's very safe and very nice place.
Where's the number one resort in the world, do you think? Is on the ocean in Cambodia?
Yeah, islands.
An island?
Yeah, we have white sands, very white sand. I think we are one of the top 10 of the white sand resort.
And it's on an island off of London. Cambodia?
Yeah, about 40 minutes by speedboat. Very, very nice place. And the blue water, very clean.
How many people are on that live on that island?
I think 80% all European people. Cambodian,
well, 20%. You have to email me a link to a resort there, and we'll have to go there someday.
Henry. Yeah.
And
very
and,
nice.
But talk about Angkor Wat. What kind of temples are those? Buddhist temples?
Actually, Angkor Wat is Hindu.
Hindu.
Yeah. Before Buddhists came, we believe Hindu, and then the Buddhists came. Now and then the new king, they built some kind like a mixed culture with Hindu and Buddhist.
So it started
together.
Off Hindu.
Yeah, the original is Hindu.
When did that start there? How long ago was the first temple? Like 1,000 years ago?
Yeah, 1,300 years ago.
So that would be 700 AD?
Yeah, that is the first one. I saw the picture outside. I saw your
The
sons.
First one was 700 AD.
Yeah.
1,300 years. That's before Genghis Khan.
Yeah.
Wow.
But we built that. That is a... Hindu style.
That was Hindu style.
Yeah.
And then when did Buddhism come to Angkor Wat?
I think it's 300 after the Hindu Then the Buddhists came.
And today in Cambodia, 50 million people, what would be the number one, the biggest religion in Cambodia?
The Buddhists.
The Buddhists?
Yeah.
What percent would you think that is?
I think 95%, and then 3% Muslim, and then 2% Christian.
95% Buddhism.
Yeah.
3%
Muslim,
2% Christian. And would you recommend that they take the 6-hour bus ride to Angkor Wat or the 6-hour speedboat up the river?
You can have boats, but I recommend by road is more convenient because now we have built very large express road that you can take about 4.5 hours only.
Oh, you can drive there in 4.5 hours?
Yeah, 4.5 hours.
And then how long would the boat take?
The boat take about 6 to 7 hours. But it's good view as well. If you want the natural views,
and then
you
along,
go to the river.
Along the bus route, 4.5 hours, would you see many dental offices along the rural line?
Oh, very, very, very few.
What about in Angkor Wat? How many people live in Angkor Wat?
In the town, we have about 20 dental clinics, private dental clinic.
In Angkor Wat?
Yeah, in Angkor
Wat. And what would the population there be?
300,000.
300,000. And have you ever been to the United States? Have you ever been to my country, the United States?
Yes.
Which cities did you visit in the United States?
I went to New York, New Jersey, California, Atlanta, Florida, yeah.
And what was your favorite city in the United States?
California, San Francisco.
That's mine too. That's my favorite.
Very good.
Well, we were just there.
Full
we
years. I love. I went there many times.
Yeah, we just went there for New Year's Eve. Well, hey, I want to say that it is a complete honor that you let me come into your dental clinic.
That's my privilege and honor.
And spend an hour with all my homies in 153 countries, sharing your stories. It's been an amazing hour. Thank you for all that you do
for
dentistry.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.